following is a video presentation of a worship service at Orrville Baptist Church.
Today. I think I'm a little loud. I don't know. Good to see all of you on this rainy Sunday morning. It's dry in here, and so we're glad to have a place that we can gather and worship, and good to see each of you being here on this rainy Sunday morning, and pray that the Lord will bless you. And those who are joining us online, we again want to encourage you to consider coming and joining us in person. As I've said many times during our welcome on Sunday morning, there's no better place than to be able to gather in person. No substitute for that. I do know we have a lot of folks that are out who are under the weather, and some are recovering from procedures, but we are glad that you are here. And in a moment, we're going to have a special prayer. As you know, we all have been following and monitoring what's going on in Ukraine with the invasion of Russia into that area, and there's just so much that's involved in that, and we certainly want to spend a little time in our prayer time not only praying for our church and our community and our country, but we want to pray for what is taking place in Ukraine and ask God to intervene and show His mercy on behalf of the Ukrainian people. I know there are a lot of thoughts as to the whys and the rationale behind the invasion, but that's something that everybody has their own personal thoughts on, but we certainly are going to be praying. So let's stand together as we are looking today at one of our messages in our series, Sam's Standalone Messages. And we're going to be looking at a passage out of Genesis 47. So turn in your Bible to Genesis 47. And we're going to look at a couple of verses And we're going to look at the life of Jacob, more particularly as he comes to the end of his life, as he comes to the conclusion of his journey on earth. Notice what it says about Jacob in verse 28 of Genesis 47. Jacob lived in Egypt 17 years, and the total years of his life were 147. Now pay careful attention to verse 29. Verse 29 says, when the time drew near for Israel, and that name Israel is another name for Jacob, when it came time for him to die, he called for his son Joseph and said to him, since I have found favor in your eyes, put your hand under my thigh and promise that you will show me kindness and faithfulness. Do not bury me in Egypt, but when I rest with my fathers, carry me out of Egypt and bury me where they are buried. I will do as you say, Joseph said. Well, be seated, and we're going to have a special prayer, and you'll keep your Bible open there. We're going to be looking at a couple of other texts of scriptures in chapters 48 and 49. But join with me in prayer this morning as we pray for what's going on in Ukraine. Father, it is very obvious the need of prayer, not only for our country and our community and our church, but Lord, in these recent days with the invasion of Russia into Ukraine, the rationale behind that and the motivation, only you know what's in the heart of Putin and that country. Our prayer today is that somehow, some way, that Russia would see the importance of withdrawing its troops and stopping this invasion. There's nothing to gain but heartache and bitterness and hatred and death and destruction as a result of this invasion. Our prayer is for this country, this independence of Ukraine that they have so longed for the last 20, 30 years. We pray for protection, and we pray for those nations, including ours, that are resourcing the Ukrainian people, not only with dollars, but military equipment, for them to be able to stand and defend their independence and freedom. And so, Lord, we pray that you would be gracious and intervene on their behalf. We pray for their peace and protection. And we realize, Lord, that there will come a time, and perhaps these are the beginning days, we know not, that some generation is going to see a World War III, an end-time war that will be escalated in such a way that it's just no one will be able to escape. We pray that that's not the case today. But we do know, Lord, that we are to look to you for help from heaven. And so we join in prayer with thousands of churches across this nation that are praying for Ukraine. May your will be done. And we pray that the outcome would be good for the Ukrainians, and that this would not be a war that is extended. Somehow, some way, we ask God for it to stop as quickly as possible, and no further damage. Again, we surrender our lives to you and pray for our own personal journey, that we also are in a war. It's a spiritual battle, a spiritual war. Remind us that we too face an enemy, and his name is the devil. And he's going to do everything he can to stop the Christian from moving forward in victory. But we know through you and through the Holy Spirit that you'll lead us and guide us in this day in our own personal journeys. And as we look at the life of Jacob as he comes to the end of his journey, remind us
that this message is an upbeat one, that we have much to look forward to whenever our journey has concluded. And so today, Lord, I pray that you would encourage the saints, comfort those who are afflicted and going through hardship, and Lord, help us to reach the lost. And help us most of all to give you honor and glory in all that we say and do and how we live. And we pray all of this in the matchless, mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And all God's people said, and amen.
waves over the way.
Choir, and we want to thank Brother Broadus Moody, who filled in and supplied for me last weekend while I was away. Thank you for your prayers, and I heard that Dr. Moody did an outstanding job, and they enjoyed the message that he had to share. So, Broadus, if you're listening, I know you're at your church this morning, or maybe preaching somewhere else. We just want to say thank you. What a blessing you have been to this church and continue to be. It's a blessing also to see Dale and Kathy. How you folks doing? I've been praying, as we all been praying for you. It's a delight to have you be able to get back, and we've missed you and continue to pray, and just glad to see that you were able to make it today. And Carol, praise the Lord, you finished those treatments this past week. Amen. I got on Facebook and saw Ring the Bell, and I thought, that's it. And she's got a reprieve for 2 or 3 weeks and then is meeting or has met with the doctors about further treatment. But I know she was looking forward and is looking forward to this next several weeks to get her strength back. But God bless you. We continue to pray for all, each and every one of us, and are grateful for Orrville Church and what it means to each and every member, and those who, you know, are unable to come. We miss you very much. And pray the Lord's blessings on you. Well, here we're looking at a message entitled Dying Grace. Aren't you glad that there is saving grace? When we think about the grace of God, which is God's riches at Christ's expense, giving to us really what we don't deserve, that saving grace, to know that you can be converted and the Lord can become your personal Lord and Savior when you and I give our lives to Him, just as Jacob did. And then not only does He give us grace to be saved, He gives us grace to live, doesn't He? So there is saving grace, there is living grace. And then when you and I come to the end of our journey, as Jacob did, that when we look at his story, he gives us dying grace. His grace is with us through and through. Now, when we come to the life of Jacob, as we're looking at his final days, understand what the scripture says. It says, his time drew nigh to die. His time drew near. And you know, there are many and varied euphemisms to describe death. And you probably have either said it yourself or heard someone else have used this particular euphemism. We know Paul said, our earthly tabernacle will be dissolved. That's a euphemism. He said, the time of my departure is at hand. That's another euphemism to describe death. Or the ones you've heard, RIP, rest in peace, he or she slipped away, gave up the ghost, kicked the bucket. How many of you have ever said that? We hear that all the time. And then passed away, or rounding the bend and heading home, or this one, he or she has checked out. Well, however you want to say it, it's inescapable and unavoidable that each one of us are going to have to cross over on the other side. And such is the case with Jacob. I want you to know this morning, as we talk briefly about the life of Jacob, and as he comes to the end of his life, that this is, again, not a downbeat, but rather an upbeat message. When you and I think in terms of death and dying, and we've had many or several in our church this last year that have the Lord's called home to glory. I like to call it home going. And several have gone home. But when you hear that word, dying or death, it frightens us naturally. And we don't like to think about it, or we don't like to talk about it. And I remember reading an article some years ago where a man interviewed children. And you know, children say the darndest things. And these children were ages 5 to 7. And these are actual statements when this man asked them to share their thoughts about death. And so here's what these little children, ages 5 to 7, said about death. One said, "Everybody has to die sometime, even if you don't want to." And then another, a little girl, said, "When you die, God takes care of you like your mother did when you were alive. Only God doesn't yell at you all the time." Here's another. "You have to be old before you can die, because God seems to love old people best." I thought that was pretty sweet. Here's another. "God doesn't tell you when you're going to die, because he wants it to be a big surprise." Here's one. I thought this was a very intelligent remark, and showed a lot of maturity at such a young age. "Only the good people go to heaven. The other people go to Florida, where where it's hot all the time, like Florida. Everyone is scared to die except the people who are already dead." Now here's another one. "A good doctor can help you so that you won't die. A bad doctor sends you to heaven." "When you die," here's a good one, "you don't have to do homework in heaven, unless your teacher's there too." "Grown-ups who smoke die before grown-ups who don't smoke." "Grown-ups who smoke must be in a hurry to die." And then this last one, "Everyone cries when somebody dies because they don't want to be left behind." Isn't that beautiful? I think that's the biggest thing. And when I think about these comments from these little ones, I'm just reminded over and over again throughout all the Bible that God says there's a time appointed unto all of us to die. And Jacob is a reflection and an example of really the way you and I should depart this world. And so I want you to take your outline, and I want you to see a few things, a few thoughts from Scripture that surrounded the death of Jacob. Again, his name later on was changed to Israel. That's where we get the name of the 12 tribes of Israel, from his children. Now, here's the first thing I want you to put in your outline, because all of these things ought to be indicative of your thought process and your life when it comes time for it to be your turn and my turn when we pass on. Here's the first thing that needs to be absolutely true when it comes to you passing on. He had, and you need to have, a forgiving Lord with him. And so in Genesis 48, he recounts his testimony. He's lying there in his bed with his children and grandchildren around him. And one of the things that he does before he breathes his last, he gives a brief testimony of his conversion. Listen to it as I read the scripture. Here's what he says. "And it came to pass after these things that one told Joseph, 'Behold, your father is sick and he's dying.' And he took with him his sons and he gathered his children together. And one told Jacob and said, 'Behold, your son Joseph comes to you.' And Israel," the Bible says, "strengthen himself." He had a little rally. We don't know how long that rally lasted before he actually died and breathed his last. But here's what it says. "Jacob rallied and said to Joseph, God Almighty appeared unto me at Luz in the land of Canaan and saved me and blessed me. You see, what he said to Jacob ought to be something you and I are able to say to our children and our grandchildren when we come to that point where we're ready to go to heaven. We remind them of our conversion. We have a testimony of saving grace. We can honestly and genuinely say, I've been forgiven, son. I've been forgiven, grandchildren, and I'm getting ready to go to heaven because I have a forgiving Lord with me. And you know, and I will not spend time going into that story, but when he fled from his brother Esau, Esau was about to kill his brother. And when Jacob ran, he fell asleep, he grew tired, and he laid his head upon a rock, and he had a dream, and he saw the angels of God, remember, that were coming out of heaven, going down the ladder and back up the ladder. And when Jacob awoke, he said, surely God is here in this place. And right there in that moment, Jacob was converted. Now you say, well, wait a minute. What is that story about? Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. The ladder that Jacob saw was a picture of Jesus. You say, well, that's reading into the scripture that which isn't there. Well, you are wrong, because Jesus told us what that ladder meant. The best commentary on the Old Testament is the New Testament, and vice versa. Listen to this verse. In John chapter 1, verse 51, Jesus said these words, verily, verily, truly, truly, he says that with emphasis, I say unto you, hereafter you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Now, he used that preposition in the Greek, upon, and he used the same analogy for what Jacob saw in his dream. That ladder that he saw in the Old Testament was a precursor to Jesus coming. It was a picture and emblematic of Jesus, who is the ladder. And ladies and gentlemen, no matter what anybody tells you or teaches you, or no matter what any philosopher says, there is only still one way to heaven. There's only one ladder. There's only one door, and the Bible says that Jesus is that door, he is that ladder, he is that gate, and you know the scripture very well. I am the way, Jesus said, the truth and the life. No person can come unto the Father except through me. And then he said, if any one of you, now watch this, tries to climb up another ladder, if any one of you climbs up another way, he is a thief and a robber. Now, I didn't say that. That's what the Lord Jesus Christ said about himself. And Jacob saw the Lord Jesus Christ through that ladder in that dream. And the Bible says he made an altar and he had a conversion experience. And he was now saved by grace. And he tells Joseph and his children, and he reminds them, man, I've got a testimony. I can go to heaven now because I have a forgiving Lord with me. When it comes time for you to close your eyes, do you have the assurance that you've been saved? Not religious, but saved. And there are a lot of religious people in this world, always have been and always will be, but there's only one conversion experience, one way to heaven. And I trust and pray that you will be able to have that testimony and should be able to share it with your family. Secondly, as he's ready to pass on, kick the bucket, check out, whatever euphemism you want to use. Secondly, note with me that Jacob had what I call a fruitful life behind him. Genesis 48 and verse 4, it says, "And God said unto him, Behold, I will make you fruitful." Ladies and gentlemen, it's not enough just to be saved and experience the saving grace. We need to experience a living grace where we impact somebody else's life and we produce and reflect fruit. You know, in John 15, it talks about Jesus saying, "I'm the vine, you're the branches, and anybody who's going to abide in me, you'll bear fruit." And it's important to understand that God did a work in Jacob's life. He wasn't always following God. He had times where he messed up along the way. And by the way, how many of you have done that as well? Everybody should raise their hand. I don't care who you are. It doesn't matter who you are. All of us, from the time we experience Christ, does not necessarily mean you're going to live a life of perfection and a sinless life. You are going to mess up. I've messed up so many times. You think, well, preachers don't mess up. Yes, they do. I mess up because I'm like you, human, and I am subject to mess up and do things that I shouldn't do, think things I shouldn't think. And I know God continues to work on me even after all these years. He says, listen, you're not a finished product yet. And so the Lord says, I saved you so you can bear fruit. And Jacob certainly experienced that as God took this old patriarch and made him a blessing, such a blessing that when he came to Pharaoh, this old weather-beaten shepherd named Jacob was introduced to Pharaoh because of his son Joseph, who was the prime minister. God blessed him with a lot of family and a lot of possessions. And I want to tell you the most important thing is that he spiritually finally got his act together and he had a lot of spiritual fruit he was leaving behind him. And the Bible says that by the grace of God, you and I to be able to bear fruit. Listen to this verse. Jesus said, "You've not chosen me. I chose you and ordained you that you should go forth," now listen to this, "and bring fruit, and that your fruit should remain." I heard this little poem years ago. "Must I die and empty-handed? Must I meet my Savior so? Without one soul with which to greet him, must I empty-handed go?" You and I don't want to go to heaven without producing fruit and showing fruit of our life. God didn't save us just to sit soaking sour. He wants us to be a blessing to others. And Jacob was. You know that scripture, lay up in Matthew, it says, "For yourself treasure in heaven." Listen to this verse in Revelation 14, 13. "Write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord from henceforth. Yes, says the Spirit," watch this, "that they may rest from their labors." Now watch this. "And their works do follow them." Your life and your works are going to follow you. Now, good works don't bring you to heaven, but ladies and gentlemen, good works ought to follow you to heaven. Amen? And so here is Jacob. He's on his deathbed, and he not only gives us testimony about a forgiving Lord, there is fruit behind him. But then thirdly and quickly, he had what I call a family legacy after him. Genesis 48, 4, "And said unto me, Behold, I will make thee fruitful," now watch this, "and multiply you. I will make of you a multitude of people, and will give you this land to your seed, that is your children, to your family after you for an everlasting possession." Now we can see the legacy of Jacob, can we not, when you think about the history of Israel? The nation of Israel has its roots in Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel. And from generation to generation, from that time forth, just as God said, "I'm going to bless your family, and that family is going to be multiplied." He first gave that promise to Abraham, Isaac, and then Jacob. And you and I know that God has always been with Israel in spite of their rebellion. And so there is a legacy that Jacob from heaven could look down and say, oh, look at the people of Israel that came from my loins, my children, and all that family legacy that followed after him. And so you and I need to understand that when you come to chapter 49 of Genesis, Jacob, before he passes on, in verse 28 and following, mentions the 12 tribes of Israel. And it says, and this is it that their father spoke to them and blessed them. In verse 28. And then it says, on his deathbed, he blessed his children, every one according to his blessing, he blessed them. And do you not know that he took the time on his deathbed to talk to each one of his children who ended up becoming the head of that tribe? And he gave them, listen to me, not necessarily material blessings, although that happened. What Jacob was more concerned about was not how well they would do materially in the future, but spiritually. May I say to each one of us, the greatest legacy we can leave our children and our grandchildren, the greatest inheritance you can give them, is their spiritual life. It's wonderful to be able to leave material things that you and I have accumulated over the years and in our will pass on in our estate. But I tell you, the most important thing you can do with your estate is make sure not only your children are taken care of, but that there is some spiritual blessings that you gave your children. And when they come to your gravesite, and they come to where your marker is, and they come to pay their respects year after year, some no longer do that, but there are many that will continue to visit the gravesite of that parent or that grandparent. I wonder what they will say about you and me when they stand over our grave. There lies my granddaddy, my grandma. There lies my dad. There lies my mother. And when I think about that, I think not about what the material things they gave me and the inheritance that they gave me and what they left me. I think about their faith in God and their spiritual legacy that has impacted my life. That is something silver and gold can never buy. And may it be said that when they visit your grave, my grave, there was a man or a woman that I want to emulate because of their faith. Because of their journey with Jesus, they left me a spiritual inheritance. That's what Jacob was trying to get across to his children. I heard this about 5 or 6 years ago that reflects what I'm trying to say. An old man traveling a long highway came at evening cold and gray. To chasm deep and wide, the old man passed in the twilight dim, for the sullen stream held no fears for him. But he turned, and when he reached the other side, he built a bridge to stand the tide. "Old man," cried a fellow pilgrim near, "you're wasting your time with building here. Your journey will end at close of day, and you'll never again pass this way. You've crossed the chasm deep and wide. Why build you this bridge at eventide?" The builder lifted his old gray head. "Good friend," he says, "on the path I've come, there followed after me today a youth whose feet must pass this way. This stream, which has been as nothing to me, may be a pitfall to that fair-haired boy be." You see, he too must cross in the twilight dim. "Good friend, I'm building this bridge for him." And that's exactly what you and I are doing. And may we build a spiritual bridge for our children to cross and our grandchildren to cross. Well, As I close the message out this morning, there are two final points, thoughts I want to leave you with. He had what I call a future light around him. Genesis 49, verse 10, says, "The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet." This is what Jacob is saying. "Until Shiloh come, and unto him, Shiloh, shall the gathering of people be." Ladies and gentlemen, death to Jacob was not a leap in the dark. It was a step into the light. God gave some insight to Jacob about the Messiah that was coming. God gave Jacob a revelation of the coming of the Messiah, because you know one of the names for Messiah is Shiloh. Shiloh comes from the same word, the same root as the word shalom. You know what that means, don't you? The word shalom, it means peace. And what Jacob was able to see on his deathbed, he got a glimpse into the future, and he saw the Prince of Peace who was coming to go to a cross and bringing that light and gathering all of his people unto himself. So he was able to see through prophecy on his deathbed the power and peace that comes to the Lord Jesus Christ. He saw his people until, he said, the gathering will be unto him. What was Jacob saying? There's coming a time when all the people of God are going to be gathered to him. And he then says one final thing before he closes his eyes. The last thing that I want to bring to your attention is that Jacob had, in your outline, he had faithful loved ones awaiting him. Listen to Genesis 49:29. He charged them and said to them, "I now am to be gathered to my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephron the Hittite, the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre, in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with the field of Ephron the Hittite for a possession, for a burying place." He reminded them, he said, hey, that's where they buried Abraham. And that's where they buried Sarah. There they also buried Isaac and Rebekah, his wife. And there, he says, "I buried my lovely bride, Leah." The purchase of the field and the cave was from the Hittites. And that's where I want you to take my remains. Now, listen to this last part. "And when Jacob had made an end of commanding his sons," I love this picture, "he gathered up his feet in the bed and yielded up the ghost and was gathered unto his people." Isn't that beautiful? Here is a 147-year-old man. He's now finished. And he comes to the very end and he kind of pulls up his feet under the covers and gets situated and smiles in the face of God, and he's gone to glory. But notice this last phrase, "he was gathered unto his people." What does that mean? Jacob was not merely looking for a resting place there in the field of Ephron, from they purchased from the field of Ephron the Hittite. He was not talking about that as his resting place. He was talking about going home to see his family. He knew there was going to be, when he closed his eyes, a family reunion in heaven. And he was looking forward to seeing Abraham and Isaac, his daddy, and Leah, his wife, and all of his relatives, and all the saints that have preceded him. So when he comes to the end of his journey, he closes his eyes, and now he's making his way, where? To heaven. Ladies and gentlemen, when you die and I die and we kick the bucket, that's not the end. There is life beyond this planet. Aren't you glad? There is an afterlife.
There is eternity. The Bible says God has placed eternity in your heart and mind. There is that innate desire for something beyond ourselves, beyond this world. And the Bible teaches us this is what you must do to prepare if you're going to go to heaven. Because the alternative, well, you and I don't want to think about the other option. There's no such thing as you dying and then it's all black and nothing else. There is an eternity out there that awaits every single person. And it will either be achieved in heaven, in the fellowship of the saints, in the presence of God Almighty who created us, or it will be plunging a person into a place of a pit and darkness, a place the Bible says is outer darkness, a place called hell. I didn't write that. God did. And so there's only one or two places. You don't come back. You don't. There's no reincarnation. You leave this world, it's appointed unto man once to die, but after this, the judgment. And I'm glad to know that when I read about Jacob, I'm excited to hear about that reunion. You see, he got to go home and be with all of his relatives, and he got to see God. And that future light, he saw Jesus. Now listen to this verse. I love this. This is from Jesus. It's found in Matthew 8, verse 11. And Jesus said, I say to you that many will come from the east and the west. Now watch this. And shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom ahead. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, this guy named Jacob that I'm preaching about this morning, you're going to get to sit down and talk with him face to face. From the east and the west, you and I are going to be able to talk to Abraham and those great saints that we read about and I've preached about for years. I'm actually, and you actually will be able to sit down and converse with them and fellowship with them. And say, Jacob, what? Tell me about that Luz experience. Tell me your story. I mean, we'll have all eternity. And not only that, our loved ones who have preceded us, that God's called home, that they've had that forgiving Lord with them all those years, they're in heaven. And we're going to have a wonderful reunion. And we're going to sit down with those members of Orrville Baptist Church that have preceded us, and even this past year that have left us. We miss them. We're separated from them. But when we stood at their graveside or we bid them adieu, we were not giving our final goodbyes. We're just saying goodbye for a while. We're going to see you again. And we're going to sit down and we're going to talk with them. And they're going to say, I'm glad you finally caught up with me. It's been wonderful up here. And I'm glad you're home. Now let's catch up and let's break bread together around the throne. My, oh my. Each one of you seated here today have loved ones just like I do that I'm longing to see again someday. And I'm looking forward to that grand reunion. How many of you who have been Baptists for most of your life, and you got a few years on you like I do, and we're moving toward that last bend in the road. Most of our life is behind us on earth. Remember that great Baptist pastor and preacher, Dr. R.G. Lee. Dr. R.G. Lee, pastor of that great church that Adrian Rogers pastored, followed Dr. Lee, Bellevue Baptist. And Adrian and Billy Graham and a few others were called to the bedside of Dr. R.G. Lee as God was getting ready to call him home. And they sang him almost into heaven. And just a few days after that visit, he had been in a coma. And he had opened his blue eyes just for a final moment when his daughter was there with him in the room And I especially like his daughter's name because this is the name of my grandmother, and this is the middle name of my last daughter, our daughter Katie. Mildred. We got a Mildred over here. That was R.G. Lee's daughter's name, Mildred. And he woke up just for a moment, and here's what he said to Mildred as she shares the story of Dr. Lee's passing. Mildred, he said, I see heaven. She said, tell me about it, Papa. He said, oh, it's beautiful. And he said, you know, I never did it justice. And you know, he had that great sermon, The Place Called Heaven. And he said, I never did it justice. And then he said, and Mildred, I see my mother. And she's so beautiful. She's beautiful. And when I thought about that story, I thought about my first pastor in Dayton, Ohio. One of our trustees at that church that I pastored for 10 years, Bill Stamps, had just turned 70. And unbeknown to him, because of all the years that he had smoked cigarettes, and he tried to quit them, and he finally did, but it was too little too late. It had damaged his lungs, and he ended up having lung cancer as he turned 70 years of age. They said, your life is about to end, Mr. Stamps. He said, no, it's just beginning. And I remember I was standing in the pulpit on that Sunday morning preaching after Bill had been diagnosed, and actually we had taken the choir, Joan, to sing during Christmas time to his house and sing Christmas carols and visited with him. And after that diagnosis, it was only like a month or less that he was around. I'll never forget on that Sunday morning when I was preaching, I got the call, Pastor, as soon as the sermon's over, you need to go to the hospital. Bill was on his deathbed. He's not going to last the day. And ladies and gentlemen, I'll never forget as a young pastor going into that hospital room, and all of Bill's family had been called in. All but one got there and was around his bedside. I'll never forget this great trustee and deacon of the church that I pastored. What a great example. He reminded me of Jacob and that story. I watched as his children came around his bedside, and he took his quivering hand, shaking, and put his hand on each one of their heads. And they bent down, and he whispered a prayer, and I don't know what that prayer was that he was saying to his children, but he had a word for each one of them. And I watched. I stood back. I didn't want to interfere. This was a holy time. And I stood at the doorway and watched. And then his wife, Bessie, he calls her to himself, and she lays down her head right on his chest and strokes his head and pats him on the cheek and reaches down and kisses him on the cheek. And he smiles at her, says, I love you. And then what I saw next was just an example of what Jacob experienced. She took his linens and pulled them up gently over his chest and made sure he was comfortable, and looked down at the very end of the bed and took the sheets and the covers and made sure they covered his feet. And the next thing I noticed, there was a nurse that came in, and all of a sudden the presence of God came in that room. He smiled, closed his eyes, and took one last breath. And I thought to myself, man, what a way to go. He was gathered to his people. So you see why I say this is an upbeat message? Death is not to be somber. It's to be a time of crossing over and looking for that time when we have lived for the Lord all these years and expecting the time we would go home to heaven. And the only way I know that's going to be true is that each one of us have a forgiving Lord with us, praying that we'll have fruit behind us, family legacy after us spiritually.
looking for the Messiah coming, knowing we're going to meet him, and then saying, I'm ready to be gathered for that great getting up morning and a great reunion day. You see why this is optimistic? Paul said, to live is Christ, to die is gain. Heads I win, tails I win.